Our reading this morning is from Psalm 118. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Open for me the gates of the righteous. I will enter and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord through which the righteous may enter. I will give you thanks, for you answered me. You have become my salvation. The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. The Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes. The Lord has done it this very day. Let us rejoice and be glad.
Let us rejoice and be glad. Today I want to talk about how Thanksgiving can change your life. I already mentioned that next week is the first Sunday of the season of Advent, which means today is the last Sunday in the season of Pentecost. And the season of Pentecost runs about half of the year. So way back on Pentecost Sunday, we started in that season. We come to the end of that today and then move into the Advent season next Sunday. So we have a choice, actually, today. The last Sunday in Pentecost can be Christ the King Sunday, but it always falls around Thanksgiving time. And so I wanted to just focus on Thanksgiving. And, it's a wonderful time to think about how Thanksgiving can change our lives. Do you ever think about that? We can be different people if we focus on giving thanks. And that's what I want to talk a little bit about today with you. It was the day before Thanksgiving. An elderly man in Phoenix called his son in New York. He said to him, "I hate to ruin your day, but I have to tell you that your mother and I are getting a divorce. 45 years of misery is enough. We're sick of each other. Call your sister in Chicago and let her know." Well, his son was frantic. He got on the phone with his sister right away, and his sister exploded on the phone. "Like heck they're getting divorced," she said. "I'll take care of this." And so she called her father in Phoenix, and she said, "Dad, you're not getting a divorce. Whatever you do, don't do anything until I get there. I'm calling my brother back. We'll be there tomorrow. Don't do anything. Do you hear me?" And so I hung up the phone. Man turned to his wife. He said, "Okay, honey, the kids are coming for Thanksgiving, and they're paying their own way." Well, on Thursday, we'll be gathering with family and friends, and I hope that it'll be more than just a time to maybe watch the Thanksgiving Day parade and eat food and watch football and maybe even rush off to the mall. I know some people have started doing that in recent years, but I hope it will be a time when we can really think about the things that we're thankful for. The Thanksgiving holiday, I think, is a good time for us to think about who we are in terms of our faith and our relationship to God, but also how we can transform our lives, how we can transform from being sometimes bitter and ungrateful to having that sense of joy, to being grateful and thankful people. I think God wants nothing more from us than to have that attitude of thanksgiving and gratitude. Alan Perkins says, "A thankful spirit is one of the key distinguishing marks of a Christian. It sets us apart from the world. It makes us different." We should be different because we're thankful people. And in our Bible reading for this morning that Becky shared with us, Psalm 118:1 says, "Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever." Give thanks to the Lord. His love endures forever. And so I want to talk today, first of all, about some of the benefits of what it means to have a grateful spirit. What are the benefits of having a grateful spirit? I think it's good for us to be thankful. It's good for us to be grateful. And one of the first things that we learn is being a grateful person can increase our personal happiness. It can increase how we feel about ourselves, how we feel about other people, how we feel about life. Most of us think that our happiness depends on our circumstances. It depends on what's happening to us. We've talked about this before. And if I were to ask you on a scale of 1 to 10 where you are in terms of your happiness, you might say, "Oh, I'm a 2, you know, because of what's happening in my life. I just feel like I'm a 2 right now." Or you might say, "Well, I'm an 8 because things are going great, you know. I feel really, really good about the way things are." I think we've been taught that somehow our happiness depends on what's happening to us, on our circumstances. But I think really happiness is determined by our attitude. It's a part of who we are. It's how we see things. The Apostle Paul wrote these words, and he wrote them from prison. So he's in jail, and he writes these words to the Philippians. He says, "Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice." He's in prison, and he's talking about rejoicing in the Lord always. That was a part of his perspective on life. It was how he viewed things. And sometimes we have to have the proper perspective on things. There was a young woman who wrote to her mother. She was writing home from college. She said, "Dear Mom, sorry I haven't written for a while, but I broke my arm. I broke it and my leg too when I jumped out of the second floor of my dorm when we had a fire. We were lucky. A young service station attendant saw the fire, called the fire department. They were there in minutes. I was in the hospital for a few days, and Paul, the service station attendant, he came to see me every day. And because it was taking so long to get the dorm livable again, I moved in with him. He's been so nice. I must admit that I'm pregnant. Paul and I plan to get married just as soon as he can get a divorce. I hope things are fine at home. I'm doing fine, and I'll write more when I get a chance. Love, your daughter, Susie. P.S., Mom, none of the above is true, but I did get a C in sociology, and I flunked chemistry. I just wanted you to receive the news in the proper perspective." It could have been worse, right? Happiness is really determined by our perspective in life, not by our circumstances. And if we learn to be grateful despite our circumstances, that really can improve our happiness. Being a grateful person can also improve our witness for Christ. Did you ever think about that? Having an attitude of thankfulness and joy certainly makes us better witnesses for Jesus. I think what is sad is that so many Christians have more of a negative disposition, you know, mean-spirited even sometimes, ungrateful. And sometimes we act like we've been baptized in vinegar instead of being baptized in the Holy Spirit. And it's no wonder that sometimes people criticize us as Christians because we don't seem to be very positive. Sometimes we come across very negative. But when we're thankful, when we're joyful, when we're upbeat, people have a different sense of who we are. We attract those who may be outside of the church because they want to know, what is it that makes you have that sense of joy in your life? And have you looked at the world today? How many people are discouraged? I've mentioned this before, but there have been times when walking down the street down in Philadelphia, and you know, you just look at the glazed look on people's faces. They just don't seem to have a sense of joy or purpose or hope in their lives. And you know, we as Christians should be people who are overflowing with a sense of hope, overflowing with a sense of joy. We want to share that. In 1 Peter 2, 12, it says, "Live such good lives among the pagans that they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day he visits us." Living a life of thankfulness will attract people to come and want to know what Jesus is all about. The third thing, being a grateful person will also enhance our relationships. Our relationships. You know, it's one thing I've noticed in married couples over the years, after a while, many times they become ungrateful, unappreciative of their spouses. Sometimes we just get to the point where we take our spouses for granted. And imagine how that could be different. Somebody described the first few years in a marriage this way. First of all, the husband sees his wife has a cold. He says, "You don't look too good. You should go to the hospital. I've already made the arrangements. I know the food there isn't very good. I'll have food catered in for you." The second year, he says, "You don't look so good. I've called the doctor. Go and lay down. I'll take care of the kids, and we'll make sure the doctor takes care of you." Third year, he says, "You know, you're not looking so hot. When you're done feeding the kids and cleaning up the kitchen, you ought to go lay down." The fourth year, he says, "Would you quit walking around here barking like a seal? You're going to give me your cold." You know, the longer we become familiar, the less thankful we are for each other. But husbands, imagine how your marriage could be different if maybe you surprise your wife with, you know, a little bouquet of flowers from time to time and just say, "Hey, I'm thankful, I'm grateful for all that you do in our marriage, in our family," or whatever. Wives, just think about how your marriage would improve if you just told your husband how much you appreciate him sometime. And just imagine how much better our church relations would be if we expressed thanks for each other. Instead of picking at each other's faults, which, you know, we're human and we have a tendency to do, what if we just stopped and became grateful for each other, the things that touch us? You know how the Apostle Paul started almost all of his letters in the Bible? He started them with a word of thanks. To the Romans, he said, "First, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for all of you." To the Corinthians, "I always thank God for you." To the Ephesians, "I have not stopped giving thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers." To the Philippians, "I thank my God every time I remember you." And to the Colossians, "We always thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, when we pray for you." You know, Paul, when he was writing these letters, he was writing them to churches that oftentimes he had started or he had visited with people there. And much of the New Testament is Paul's writings to these other churches in these other places. And he was writing usually because there was some issue going on, some problem going on in the life of that church that he needed to address. But he always started out by giving thanks. He started out by giving thanks for them. Imagine how much better all of our relationships and even our church relationships would be if we expressed our thanks for each other. And one other thing that having a grateful heart will help us with, and that is it'll firm up our relationship with God. And that's probably the best benefit of all. Someone once said, "God lives in two places. He lives in heaven and in a humble, grateful heart." And it's true, isn't it? It's true that God wants us to be thankful, and it firms up our relationship with him. It firms up our relationships with other people as well. I think thankfulness is something that God has built into us. You know, we talk about that God-sized hole in our heart. I think a part of that is just our thankfulness for all the many ways that God blesses us. There's something inside of each of us that needs to give thanks to God. When I spend time giving thanks for all that I have, I feel closer. And I hope that you do too. And I think that's why. You know, God created us to be thankful people. In 1 Thessalonians 5:18, Paul again, in his writings, he says, "Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus." Give thanks in all circumstances. All circumstances. It's God's plan for us to give thanks. He made us for that. He created us to have that relationship with him and to give thanks to him. And then moving on, what are some ways that we can develop thanksgiving in our lives? Well, some of that depends on how we think. You know, what is our attitude about things? And first of all, I think we want to be thankful. If we want to be thankful, we have to remember that everything we have comes from God. We want to be thankful and grateful. Everything we have comes from God. And acknowledging that everything comes from God and isn't ours is important. In Psalm 24, it says, "The earth is the Lord's and everything in it." And when we do that, we acknowledge that, you know, what we have is really just on loan from God to us. 1 Corinthians 4:7 says, "What do you have that you did not receive from God? And if you did receive it, why do you boast as though you did not?" Stories told of a poor man who was given a loaf of bread, and he thanked the baker for this loaf of bread. Baker said, "Don't thank me. You know, thank the miller who milled the flour." And so the man went to the miller. He thanked him for the loaf of bread. The miller said, "Don't thank me. Thank the farmer who planted the wheat." And so the man went to the farmer. He thanked the farmer, but the farmer said, "Don't thank me. Thank the Lord. He gave the sunshine and rain and fertility to the soil, and that's why you have bread to eat." Everything we own, everything we have, ultimately comes from God. James 1:17 says, "Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of heavenly lights, who does not change like the shifting shadows." The second way to be more thankful is to avoid complaining. That's hard for some of us, isn't it? We need to avoid complaining. I want to challenge you to take a fast from complaining. Maybe set up a goal to be through Christmas. Don't complain. No complaining about family members. No complaining about the Eagles. No complaining about someone who hurt your feelings. You know, complaining doesn't lead to that attitude of thankfulness. Dr. Dale Robbins wrote one time, "I used to think people complained because they had a lot of problems." That's the way we think, right? "I used to think that people complain because they had a lot of problems, but I've come to realize that they have problems because they complain. Complaining doesn't change anything or make situations better. It amplifies frustration, spreads discontent and discord, and can invoke an invitation for the devil to cause havoc in our lives." Complaining makes us miserable. And I think really complaining is the enemy of thanksgiving. I don't think the two can really coexist in one heart. And so I want to challenge you to avoid complaining as long as you can. Philippians 2:14, again, Paul's writing. He says, "Do everything without complaining or arguing, so that you may become blameless and pure, children of God without fault in a crooked and depraved generation, in which you shine like stars in the universe." I love that idea, shining like stars in the universe. And one last thing we can do to produce that spirit of thanksgiving, and that is develop a daily discipline of giving thanks. A daily discipline of giving thanks. Not just one day out of the year, not just one week, but how can we daily give thanks? Maybe at the end of day, you know, just reflect on what's happened that day and a little prayer, just thank God for whatever blessing, whatever thing you can be thankful for. Ephesians 5:19 says, "Sing and make music in your heart to the Lord, always giving thanks to God the Father for everything." I think there's two key words there. Always is a key word, but everything, not just on thanksgiving, always giving thanks for everything that comes from God. There was an old hymn, I used to have these words: "When upon life's billows you are tempest-tossed, when you are discouraged, thinking all is lost, count your many blessings, name them one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord has done." Thanksgiving is it's a daily discipline. I read one time, if you own one Bible, you are abundantly blessed, because a third of the people in the world don't have access to a Bible. We probably have Bibles all over the place in our homes. If you woke up this morning with more health than illness, you are more blessed than 1 million people who will not survive the week. If you've never experienced the danger of war, the loneliness of imprisonment, the agony of torture, or the pangs of starvation, you are more fortunate than 500 million people on earth. If you have food in your refrigerator, clothes on your back, a roof over your head, $20 in your pocket, and a place to sleep, you are richer than 75% of the world. Oh God, forgive us when we whine. I want to leave you this morning with a list of questions that test whether we are grateful people or not. The first one: which do you tend to talk about more, your blessings or your disappointments? The second one: are you a complainer, always grumbling, always finding fault with your circumstances? Three, are you content with what you have, or always dissatisfied and wanting more? Four, do you find it easier to count your blessings, or is it easier to count your afflictions? Five, do you express thanks to others when they help you, or you just take it for granted? And six, would others say that you are a thankful person? Count your blessings. Thanksgiving can change your life. Let's pray. Loving God, we are grateful. We're thankful. And we pray that we would be thankful people in all that we do, in the way that we live our lives, in the way that we reach out with the good news of your love, in the attitude that we have, an attitude of hope, an attitude of joy, as opposed to an attitude of disappointment and discouragement. Lord, help us to find the things in our lives for which to give you thanks. And help us to realize that a thanksgiving can change us, can change our hearts. So we thank you. We thank you especially for your son, Jesus. We pray in his name. Amen. Mm-hmm.